Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Dogumentary TV, and this is the very first podcast of the YouTube channel dedicated to dog breed documentaries. Today, my first guest will be Mr. Dean Ross out of North Texas. Mr. Ross, how are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good.
Happy to hear that. I'm happy to hear that. Please tell me who you are and your expertise with the dog breeds. I'm sorry, with the Great Danes.
I'm just kind of a hobby hunter. I don't do this professionally or anything. I kind of did it as a part-time job before the hog market kind of went south, the buying market on them. But right now, I just kind of go out and do it by myself just for the simple enjoyment of it, pleasure of it, and the camaraderie with the dogs. I really like that.
All right, great. So tell me, what was your very first experience dealing with dogs? You may be going back to your youth. When was your first introduction to dogs in general?
As far back as I can remember, I've been around dogs, but my parents had my little chihuahuas when I was little. I had asthma when I was little, and they believe that the chihuahuas helped with that. So I had them. And then later on, probably when I was 7 or 8, went and lived on about a 20,000 acre ranch with my parents. And there we had a lot of cattle dogs. It was Blue Laces, Black Mouth Curs, some Border Collies, and also Great Pyrenees and Anatolian Crosses for sheepdogs or goat dogs.
Right.
And then later on, I was probably around 34 years old that I really got into these pig dogs.
And that's when you start. And that's when you started hunting with the dogs, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
And what brought about the inspiration to start hunting with the dogs?
My love for hunting in general. I've always been pretty blessed as a hunter. I went from hunting with a rifle and a blind to spot and stalk, then to hunting with a bow, and then spot and stalk with a bow. And I really got to where I like shooting pigs with a bow. And for some reason, I transitioned to just trade bow in for a catch dog, primarily a dog that was fast enough. I thought I could do the hunting if the dog could do the catching, and I bring the game out alive and sell it.
Okay.
That's kind of how my progression to this style of dog went.
Okay, so what exactly are your catch dogs of choice?
They are a mixture of Dane, Wolfhound. I've got some stag in there, like a lot of pit in there, and I've got Cane Corso, and that's about it. Some Boer Bull and stuff, I didn't add that in there, but the Dane, the Wolfhound, stag, and Cane Corso, I've added in the pit as well.
So would all these breeds be in one dog, or do you have combinations that create different types of dogs?
It's kind of a mixture of different dogs have different percentages of stuff in there. Some dogs don't have any pit in there, and some have more than others. It's kind of like for everything you add in, every breed that you add in, you take away different characteristics and attributes from something that you've previously added in. And so it's kind of a delicate balance to adding stuff in. And it's a lot of times you'll make a breeding to do a breeding down the line. You're not necessarily after the first breeding that you're making, or this breeding that you're making isn't necessarily what you're after. It's you're doing that breeding to, let's say, a pit and Dane cross, in order to get a little hardness in your line by using the pit. You kind of offset the short and small pit with a Great Dane. And that way by adding that pit in there to increase a uniform hardness in your dogs, you're not diluting the size too much by just making a straight cross to a pit. You've got the Dane in there, which helps to offset little pit. And also it brings a lot of characteristics and attributes of its own to the breed as well. But that's kind of how I do that. So different dogs have a mixture of a different percentage of stuff in them.
Okay, so you're mixing these kind of, bring your dogs in teams, correct? All right.
Pairs, yes, sir.
So when you're creating these dogs, are you trying to create two dogs that are similar, or are you trying to create two types of dogs that work best together?
No, I'm just trying to create two dogs that are similar.
Okay.
What I'm breeding for is form for function. And that's just kind of it's all in one dog. When I take a pair of dogs out and go hunting, if there's multiple pigs there, I want each dog to grab its own pig. And I'm looking for similar type dogs and uniform dogs for form for function. And to say if one was a kind of a pit and another one was a Dane, it would it'd be kind of lopsided. I'd figure my Dane would catch all the time and in a shorter distance, and the pit would just it'd be a good while for that he could run one.
So in this one dog that you're looking for, this dog that you're trying to create, what are the attributes that you find you need best possible for the best possible outcome in terms of catching pigs?
It is three attributes are of the utmost importance, and they are the speed, hardness, and size. And without if those aren't equal, if one of them is lacking, then the others have to make up for it. And your injuries will go up, your efficiency and your effectiveness isn't there. The form for function is tanked, all because you're lacking in one of those areas. So those are the primary things that helped us to help us be so effective and efficient. And you also have hunt style and nose and stuff in there too that are important, but they're not important to doing this so efficiently and injury free.
All right. So this is supposed that every litter you had was 10 dogs, just to make it an even number. How many successful or good dogs do you think you get out of every 10 dogs? Your program.
I don't know. I have pretty good, pretty high. The bar is set pretty high for me at where I stay the bar. My standards are much greater than what everybody else's are. To me, probably one in five dogs that I keep, because it's really a hard question to answer because of my breeding style. I don't have universal. They're crossbred dogs, and I do one breeding to make enough to add in to another dog. And so I'll keep a dog from that litter and use it best I can. It's not as effective or as efficient as what the offspring is going to be. I know it's really a hard question to answer. For the expectations that I have upon the particular, I'd say about half of them meet my expectations.
You're a big fan of working Great Dane. What do you love about just the pure Great Dane in terms of it working as a catch animal?
The Great Dane represents the form for function dog breed better than for catching boar, better than any other breed, full breed out there. It's the original boarhound. It's called a boarhound. For today, you can look up boarhound and you can get Great Danes or dogs used for catching boar. But the Great Dane was the original boarhound, and as such, it was called that. It fulfilled the role to such a high degree. They're originally pretty fast dogs. They have great nose. Their size, it provides the function to control a big boar. And without that size and without the speed and hardness that a good Great Dane has, they're in a class of their own. It's either the pit fills a niche, like a lead-in catch dog. He's not fast enough to catch its own pig. Likewise with the Dogo and stuff, it's almost fast enough, but it still fills the same niche that the pit does. The Dane, he excels and is not in the same. He works as a good hunting dog and a catch dog both. And so it's why I really like the Dane as the Dane breed for finder holder hunt.
Why do you think today more people aren't using the Great Dane as a hunting dog?
Here in America, they use the bay dogs and pits, bay dogs and lead-in style catch dogs. For some reason, the Dane is just not on their radar. The form for function is not a necessity these days. Efficiency is not, in today's society, it's just hobbyists and stuff. It's not a your life depends upon it style of efficiency and stuff. The Dane is also seen as just a pet, no longer a hunting dog. It is not on anybody's radar as far as a hunting dog. It is a strange foreign deal to them. If you see one, there's a lot of them, and they're just house dogs. Predominantly, the people that own them have them living in their house, or they call them fur babies and stuff, and it's just they've been bred. The stewards of the Dane breed have fur probably for the last 50 years at least have been just breeders. The best representations of the Dane no longer are no longer in the hands of working homes or people breeding them for their working abilities. It's just the pet type mentality. And they've kind of evolved into a dog that they originally we're not. And people just think of them as pets, just overgrown lap dogs and stuff.
All right, so another type of dog that you hunt with, you call them hairy dogs. What exactly are hairy dogs?
Hairy dog is a loose term that a certain type of pig doggers use to describe the type of finder holder that they're using. It's predominantly a term that you find used in Australia. The hairy dog is a wolfhound-based dog. It's got a lot of mastiff in it. Some stags, they'll have a lot of bully or bull terrier in them. And this is predominantly in Australia. And they're pretty hairy. They're not hard to look at. And hard to love. They got like a face only a mama would love. But they're very effective, very efficient dogs. They're very good at their job. And the other style finder holder type dog over there is a bull Arab. And to say a hairy dog, it tells you what style of dog, what style of finder holder you're using. You're not using a bull Arab. Here in America, you're not using a Dogo. You're using wolfhound based type dog.
So, what are the typical crosses that are in your hairy dog?
Wolfhound based Dane is going to be in there a lot. Different forms of various forms of mastiff, either Borbal, Cane Corso, or English or Bull Mastiff. Will be in some of them. Mine have a little bit of Borbal, some Cane Corso in there. Pit is often found in there. Pit or Bull Terrier. Pit predominantly with my dogs. Bull Terrier predominantly in Australia with their dogs in place of the Pit. A lot of Staghound in those in Australia. Since there's really only two people here in America that are breeding them, me and one of the guys who got me started in it, my mentor and stuff. He's not a big fan of the stags, and I had a real good one. And as a consequence, he wound up, his blood is in almost all my dogs, just due to one breeding I did with him to a wolfhound. It's predominantly wolfhound, stag, a bull breed of the pit or the bull terrier, and then a mastiff, whether it be Cane Corso or English mastiff, bull mastiff, or Borbal.
And typically, what's the size on your hairy dogs, height and weight?
Mine are typically between 27 inches on the females up to about 28 inches, and then the males are 28 to 30 inches. Weight, anywhere from 90 to 120 pounds. I prefer 120 pounds is pretty heavy for a hairy dog. He's probably going to throw a lot to the mastiff side. He's going to be a pretty dense, thick type dog if he's 120 pounds. I like him a little leaner than that.
Earlier you were saying that Great Dane pretty much for the most part has been bred for family companionship. In terms of when you go out searching for Great Danes to bring into your program, who do you find, what typical group of people have typically have the best examples of the breed?
With the Great Danes really owned by nobody but two classes that own them. It's the show people and the non-show people, backyard or pet owners. The show people they'll have by far the best structured dogs. There are physical structured dogs. There are confirmation wise and stuff. They're really regal and royal looking dogs. Mentality, they do breed for a stable mentality. Nothing that's really and be shy or aloof, but nothing that's aggressive either. They're all around good dogs, but they're not bred for the working abilities. That's out the window for everybody that breeds Dane. So they're going to have like, if you're going to buy a puppy, I would go with the show dog stuff. As far as the pet owners and the breeders and stuff, they're not as meticulous in their breeding. It's like they fall in love with their dogs and they want them to have a family of their own type deal. Not a lot of discretion is used with the color or structure. It's what I'm trying to say. It's not a lot of structure or thoughts given to like the breed standard, whether it be color, structure, or mentality. We find a lot of unstable dogs bred by the pet owners. They're aloof and shy, maybe a little timid or have anxiety and stuff. They might have structural problems. You might have them, the cow hocks and stuff. These guys, they never know. They don't know what the cow hocks means or anything. These Danes still get around pretty good. It's just a structural problem. It's not really it's a structural strike against them. You don't want to really want to breed that into your next line of dogs. And then also the color. Danes have a Harlequin color to them, a Harlequin and Merle gene, a Harlequin gene. But breeding that back to itself can produce deafness and produces a lot of white dogs. White and Danes, or a white Dane, is something that you predominantly want to stay away from, blue eyes and stuff. That's getting pretty close to the gene that causes a lot of deafness and problems, even problems with their eyes, their ability to reflect light. I forget what those rods are called, but at night you can shine a light in their eyes and it doesn't reflect any light back. It's just, you just see the dog there. Whereas a dog that has normal eyes, well, it'll have like two flashlights shining back at you. That's a result of these people breeding this color to one another, like Harlequin color to a Merle color, or a dog that has a little ticking of Merle. He's still carrying that gene, even though it's not real dominant in his appearance. He's still got that gene. So if you're breeding to another Harlequin dog, you're going to get potentially some dogs that lack hearing or lack the ability to reflect that light back.
With the with the gene pool of Great Dane being pretty much locked up within the show world, or not necessarily being what you want in the pet world, how do you go about sourcing Great Danes for your breeding program, or your hunting program rather?
Craigslist is a good way, believe it or not. And if you really know what you're looking for, first off, you got to start off with, you really need to know what a Dane's supposed to be. Just a regular, the Danes run they're not real consistent, I'll put it that way, as far as one being a real good, hard catch dog and another, whereas another one, he might only bark at a pig. The real good hard catch dog, he might not be fast enough to run his own pigs down. It's really a hit and miss type deal. When you get it right, it's phenomenal. And there's that dog is hard to beat, even for somebody like me who has been breeding hairy dogs to do that job for years and years. Craigslist. It's go on there and you read, you can pick up on, these people will tell you a little bit about the dog and you can just decipher kind of what's going on. They're a problem dog is a good dog. That's what catches my attention on Craigslist, is these people are having a problem with their dog. They're not really going, a lot of them are wanting to place it in a good home. They're really not upfront and honest with the extent of the problem with what the dog's doing. Some of them aren't. And what you're looking for is these people that are describing game and a prey drive and a lot of energy in the dog. For instance, an example I'll give you that I'll run across is the Danes that live in the country. You're going to see some of these guys that says, the Dane is, my dog's killing the chickens. Or my Dane is attacking my horse and trying to catch my horse. He's already caught it on the nose and stuff, and the horse is just flipping out and stuff. I can't let the dog outside the house, or it got off the chain, or it jumped the fence, or something got out of the fence and is attacking my livestock. It's catching my cows or something like that. And they're beside themselves because nobody wants a problem dog like that. They might have given $2,000 for the puppy, but it is such a headache and a source of a problem for them that they're willing to give up the dog for $150, $300 or so, if you are the answer to their prayers. And of course, that kind of Dane is exactly the kind of Dane that is a good prospect to make a catch dog. The mentality's there. We just got to purchase the dog and find out if the athleticism is there. The city Dane, he is, what you see there a lot is a lady will have it, or a couple has had a baby or something, small kids. And the Dane is just too energetic for them. They're afraid that he's knocking the kids over, or it's an elderly lady or couple, and they're afraid that the dog's going to knock them over. That's kind of a hint. And then they want to walk the dog outside, exercise it. A lot of people want to take their dogs to the dog park and stuff, but they're having troubles because it's wanting to chase cats. Like it sees a cat and then just takes off after it and jerks them down. It pulls really hard to get the lead and stuff. And also, same thing with squirrels. And so they're having a problem with just exercising the dog. They can't get control of the dog. This dog is exhibiting some prey drive beyond a lot of other Danes, and that kind of, that's a big, you know, a big flag there that gets your attention. And so you talk to these people, they're not quite as easy to get. They think that the Dane can still be rehabilitated with the right person. They still like to see it as a house pet and stuff. And so it takes a little bit more to finesse to get that dog, maybe a little bit more money, $400 or so. But it's a problem Dane, and they're needing it gone. It can really, time is of essence for them too. So Craigslist is a good place. If you kind of know what you're looking for and you read enough about them, if you look at enough Danes on Craigslist, you'll start seeing that.
If you're sourcing these dogs from pet homes, are you running into issues? Do you accept dogs that have been spayed or neutered already? Or
no, that's one of the first questions I ask. Is if it's not already in the information, then that is the first question I ask. If the dog has been spayed or neutered, for one, I'm not interested in Dane that I can't incorporate into my hairy dogs. Cross to it. That's one of the big purposes of wanting the Dane is to cross it into my hairy. The spaying and neutering also, it shortens the lifespan of the dog. The sooner you do it, the more health problems that you can expect to see in especially large breed dogs like the Dane. When you take away a dog's, when their hormones, the testosterone and the estrogen, when you take away that stuff, that is essential for a dog's growth and development, structurally and or physically and mentally. Structurally, if you neuter a dog, such as a Dane, it takes so much longer to mature than small dogs do, and them growth plates stay open for a lot longer period of time. And when you neuter a Dane, spay them, then those growth plates, especially in back legs and femurs and stuff that take longer to mature, they stay open even longer. And so they get a little bit taller and stuff. And also in the back end and then faster maturing part of the dog that closes up a little faster. And so you have structural imbalance in those dogs. And plus they'll have the early onset of they're susceptible. The early onset of arthritis, cancers, tumors, almost thyroid problems are a immediate thing that you think of when you don't have hormones. Endocrine disease, the endocrine gland, it starts trying to produce the hormones to make up for the lack thereof, and it becomes so taxed that it eventually wears down and you might get cancer in that gland. Or Cushing disease is a problem. There's all kinds of host of issues that result physically from removing their hormones, especially at such a young age. After the dog is matured, has reached maturity, it's not as big a deal. It doesn't affect them as much, but research shows that it still shortens their lifespan, but not as dramatically as it does when they're so young. But for the health problems, and I just assume I have a health problem when I take a dog on, and then two, I'm not interested in it. If it's a good dog, I'm going to want to breed to it.
So, going through the process, combing through Craigslist and identifying some good prospects. And once you get a dog to your home, what is the process of getting to assessing that dog's ability to be a good hunt dog, be a part of your program?
When you get the dog home, you really start finding out a lot about the dog. It's mentality and stuff. You're real hopeful when you get the dog, but sometimes it's about half of them work out. I get better and better at choosing them. But the mentality is, Dane needs to have a lot of nerve. And it shouldn't be, even if it does make a good pig dog, but it's shy or aloof or something, that's something I don't want to add in. And how they describe the dog, they may think the dog is just real bold and courageous, yet barks out of a defense. Or because it's scared, the booger barks. And so you'll kind of start finding that out for yourself once you get the dog home. You want to see a dog that's pretty stable-minded and is physically sound. I'll take the dog out for, first you want to get the dog used to you. You don't want to just turn the dog loose and then it runs off. It needs to know this is home and stuff. And I'll start working with the dog in a lead, a short lead, long lead, and then a collar. That doesn't all happen in one day, a short lead. That'll happen for a couple of days, and we'll put the dog on a long lead. But while doing that, I'm also watching his gait, how he how the dog, his stride and stuff, his fluid of movement that he has and stuff. I'm hoping to see a good Dane, has a real good gait to him, real efficient movement. There's not a lot of wasted movement there. The dog just seems to glide. Look at that, in a Dane, you don't really forget it. It's majestic type deal, but it's going to be less and less of them that have that nowadays, especially when a Dane lopes. It's a floating type deal. It's like he never really hits the ground. And whereas some are just ground pounders, and they just, it makes your joints hurt when they run. But so I really want to, that really impresses me when I see a Dane like that, when he's got that type of movement to him. And show dogs are really going to exhibit that to you're more out to find show dogs that exhibit that than you are just indiscriminate breeding that's done by most people.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay, so you got them home, but what about, you need to do any kind of training, putting obedience on them, and give them any commands?
Yes, sir, absolutely. That is extremely important because of the nature of the dog. And what you're fixing to make out of it. You're about to make, if a Dane was an apex predator, much like the deer hound and the wolfhound. And when you revitalize that in a dog, you need to have control over that dog, a psychological control over that dog. And to get that, it is you gain that psychological control through physical control. And that's through your lead training, short lead, a long lead, and then an e-collar. And what that does is when you're teaching the dog that you have control over the dog. And then also you're working, teaching it commands also, especially in the long lead. But a short lead is you have control over the dog and his movements. He moves when you move, et cetera, et cetera. Long lead is you give the dog a lot of freedom to move on his own. But then you start working on his recall, like say a 30-foot rope. Put the dog on a 30-foot soft rope or soft line and kind of take him for a walk. And when he gets out there on the end of it and kind of is dilly-dallying around, doing his little thing, smelling and stuff, you want to call him back to you. If you don't come back to you, you give him a little tug. And you still got control over that dog, even though he's so much farther out than he was before. And you're instilling that psychological deal in the dog where you have control over this dog, even though he's not right there at you. Same thing with collars. It's the same principle. When he's now 100 yards away from you, he's thinking that, yeah, you can't get him. You don't have no control over him or nothing. And when you show him that you do, you don't have to. You'd be responsible with an e-collar. It is, an electric collar is wildly abused. Just because of people don't understand dog psychology, really. They think that they're doing good. They want to do good, but they don't really know what's going on. They don't really know how a dog processes stuff. And so they don't use it correctly most of the time, which means that they wind up using it too much or what have you. You can buzz that dog, not hurt him or nothing, but buzz him. And when you give them same commands to him and he looks up, whoa, he'll come back to you. And the farther on out he gets, you practice that recall. When he's about 100 yards out or what have you, it normally 100 yards, 200 yards, there's not a lot of difference. The dog's pretty well got it by then. They also, too, you can work on stock breaking. Stock breaking and trash breaking on a short lead or long lead. Long lead especially. If you want to do that before you go out and put an e-collar on him, it's not wise to do that. You want the dog to understand that before you put an e-collar on him, what the rules are and what he's getting in trouble for or what you're buzzing for. If you don't understand that, you're confusing the dog. And so a long lead is a good way to, again, get that through to the dog. That's something that he's not supposed to do. And you can also incorporate the long lead with an e-collar. And if he still stays engaged after you tell him no and you kind of give him a tug, then you can buzz him a little bit and provide some more stimulation to him and let him know that it's serious, and I'm the authority here. It's my rules. We can't have a dog that's fast enough and hard enough to catch most any livestock or trash or non-prey species, non-target items. If you have a dog that's fast enough and hard enough and it's got the prey drive to kill anything that it basically wants, you need to have control over that dog. And that's how we get control over that dog there is trash breaking and teaching to come back to you. Set and stay. Don't really use an electric collar for that. That works fine on a long lead. Once the dog kind of sees you as an authority figure and grows to trust you, once you have the respect of the dog, you have communication with the dog. Danes especially are pretty eager to please. And when you start breaking through to that psychological control, which you develop that in the dog, training goes real easy with Danes, usually.
I was going to ask you that.
Set and stay are pretty important to me. The know, the dog's obviously got to learn know and get back. Load up. I want them to load up on the back of a pickup by themselves, jump up there by themselves without me having to put them up there. So they need to do that. The need to do that, that all goes inside of or for once a dog is tripped, when you've gone past the working in the yard and stuff, he's not triggered or excited or anything. He knows the commands, rules and stuff. But then you can start working, putting the dog in situations where it's you're working inside what I call a trip trigger, or the dog's engaged. He's switched on. It's kind of like a pit. People are pretty familiar with pits. It's kind of the same mentality as a pit. When a pit is, switches on, when somebody sees that for the first time, especially some family member, and their dog just flips out and attacks something and can't get it to let go, that's the dog being switched on. Oh gosh, I didn't know my dog was like that. And he wouldn't listen to me. I wasn't even there. I couldn't communicate with the dog. He wouldn't do what I was telling him to do, and he didn't know what to do. There's total panic in that person. Danes are much the same way, or good Danes are. When they get switched on like that, they're real similar, and they're real similar to a pit when he gets switched on. If you don't have a handle on them, you're really not going to get that dog to let go when he's switched on, with a pig. I've never really seen that with another dog or with Danes in any other situation other than, let's say, a pig. It might be that way with cows or horses or something, but in that time, he's pretty new to it. They're a little bit more sensitive than a pit to their owner when they're switched on. But as they grow in confidence, especially with pigs, boy, you talk about some hardness and some stubbornness is to get through to if you don't already have a handle on that dog. And so being able to communicate with that dog when he is triggered like that means you got to put your work in at the house, get the dog to realize you as a respect you as the authority figure. You're not a training. It's not a rewards based training where the dog does it for treats and stuff. The dog's not going to let go of a pig because you're trying to convince it with a pizza, with a cube of meat or a little cookie or something.
Got the meat already.
Yeah. He's got what he wants already. He's letting go because the boss man is telling him to let go, and he respects that boss man. And so really, you don't have to get rough with them if you put your time in. You don't need a brake stick. A brake stick is like a Teflon type little piece of strap that you'll put in a dog's mouth and kind of press down on their tongue, makes it a reflex where they open their mouth, and another guy's pulling the dog off the pig. And that's willful defiance. And with a dog not letting go like that when he's being told to, when he knows the difference. And then I'm not going to let willful defiant do like that or be allowed to nurture itself. So how I get a dog to let go is I take possession of the pig. He's holding it. And so I go up there, I grab it by the back legs and flip it over and get over on its side, pull a front leg up, and then pull a front leg of the pig up. And I'll then have control over the pig. I'm sitting on it with my knees over on the back side of it, and I'm pulling the leg up, and with my free hand I'm telling the dog no, and I'll touch it on the head. And after I touch it on the head, the dog then lets go and backs up. He's still engaged and he still wants that pig, but I start giving him verbal commands. I tell him no, and I'll tell him to sit. He'll back up a few feet and sit down. And you keep eye contact with that dog until he relaxes or he submits, he disengages. You can see it. And until he does that, you need to keep eye contact with him. You need to keep your hand up. I use a stop type signal with my open palm and my fingers up to signify the dog to stop or back. And with that being done and all of the work and stuff I've put in, he will disengage and relax. And at that point, it opens up a lot of other doors too. You have, if there was multiple pigs there, the dog is free then to roll out and go grab another pig, to find another pig out of the mob. Or if you don't want to do another 800-yard run to another catch, or you're too hot, or it's in the hot summertime and stuff, or you're on a small piece of property and you don't want to get off the property, then you just tell your dog, no, sit, and he won't get up and run off. And that's how I put a handle. And it's why it's critical to, one of the reasons it's critical to put a handle on that dog is you can send him out there to cows. Let's say pigs are in a bunch of cows. Send him out there to some cows, and he'll work through them cows so he finds the pigs and catches a pig, not the cow. And it doesn't bother the cows or anything. And livestock break and trash, like coons, skunks, deer. If the dog's running the deer and he exhausts himself and comes back all tired and stuff and you find a pig, it's your dog's wore out. Right. It just makes for a much better relationship with a dog, and you are a much better dog man. You understand, I respect dog people who know dog psychology and put a good handle on their dogs and know how to. And it makes for a lot more relaxed hunt. And it also, too, when landowners contact you with a problem, or your work for, let's say, parks or something, somewhere where the pigs are tearing stuff up, you're having an audition for them, and you show them that you've got a handle on your dog like that, even when it's engaged, you just tell it to let go of a pig and let go. That's very impressive to people, and boom, you've got that work. Now, you've got that permission.
Now, when hunting these dogs, it sounds like these hogs are alive after you guys catch them. Are you wrapping them up and taking them somewhere, or?
It depends. Half the time I do, half the time I don't. There's a market for buying feral hogs, wild hogs. It's not as strong as it's been in the past. It seems as time goes on, it's a little weaker and weaker, especially in the past, in light of the events of the past year or 12 months or 13 months. Since the COVID stuff hit, and the processing plants have been affected by workers with COVID and politics and all kinds of stuff. That's drove the market down, the price down. And anyway, I don't sell as many of them now because I can't. It's a lot of work for not a whole lot of money. Most pigs won't bring a whole lot. Big boar, they'll still bring 60, 70 bucks. But you catch three or four of them on a pretty good night, and It's some pocket change. Plus, it pays for your fuel expenses and the fun you had, and plus a little more to add in your pocket, or it buys you some dog food or another tracking collar, or you can put the money to your dog, or put the money to date night, whatever you want.
And, that's right. That's right.
And also, I do stab them or dispatch them. I use a pretty long knife for that. It seems to do the job pretty quickly. It's about, I'm going to say, about 11 inches long, the blade is. And you run that in the right spot, and in about 3 seconds, that pig's over on the side. Whereas a shorter knife, it seems like it just lasts forever. I tend to just let a lot of kids and first-timers just use my knife. It can go a lot better. But I do feed a lot of pigs to my dog. I feed, that's about 90% of what they consume is what they catch. I don't feed a whole lot of kibble.
So, now, have you ever had your dogs catch a pig? You get on top of them? In the process of trying to apprehend them, lose control, and your dog has to come and rescue you? Has that ever happened?
I've been in a precarious situation once when I run some bay dogs and lead-in style catch dogs before I hunted this style of dog. Back when I first started, I did. The reason for that was stabbing them was taboo for me and my partner and my buddy that I was hunting with. We believed in just putting hobbles on them and selling them. A dead hog didn't bring us any money. Of course, the market for them back then was a lot stouter, too. You get pretty decent money for a pretty good pig. And so it was something that I didn't do. I did it after that. I wound up letting that pig get up. I was the only one there, and I don't really want to go into it. Long story. Probably ain't got enough time. But, yeah, I wound up on the back of that pig for a little while until I could get off of him and get up Creek Bank.
That's it.
Go ahead.
So in terms of catching boar, there are a lot more dogs, at least today, that are more popular. We spoke earlier a little bit about the Dogo. What are your impressions with the Dogo, and why did you decide to do the hairy dogs and the Great Danes as opposed to Dogo catching boar?
Hold on just a second. Let me back up to your last question and give you a pretty good answer with these type dogs. What I do see a little bit is I mentioned that I'll run these dogs in a pair usually, and out of a mob, each dog will catch its own. And if I got guests there and stuff, I'll send guests after one pig. Our guest might have his own dog. I'll send the guest after his own dog or one dog, and I'll go to another. And sometimes these pigs, they'll come back. There's no barking. These dogs don't bark. Everything's silent. A lot of the pigs don't even realize the danger. They just know other pigs are running, and so they're going to run. Or they'll hear some squealing, and they know stuff's not right, so they'll kind of ease off a little bit. But if they hear some squealing, some of the pigs will come back to that squealing and try to assist the distressed pig. And it wasn't about 4 weeks ago, I had a guest from East Texas. He had a dog. His dog caught one pig. My dog caught another. And he had said, when we got up there to him, they were about 15 yards apart. And he had said, the pigs are coming back. And I was like, I'm used to that. And I didn't really think a whole lot of it. And I could hear the pigs. So I was like, they're pretty close. I looked over there with my light, where this is in the middle of the night, down on the edge of the field. I looked over and, heck, he's kicking dust up with his feet to try to keep a pig back off of him. An old boar that had come in to try to assist. And I just flipped my pig and I told my dog, get off. And he went over there and caught that boar that was going to harass my buddy over there. But he couldn't get his dog off the pig. He didn't have quite a good handle on his dog. He couldn't get his dog off to catch that pig, so my dog caught it. But anyway, that's what I'll see. Situations like that are not uncommon. They don't always unfold like that. Usually it's the bold pig will just come in and hang out about 20 yards away. If they see you there, your headlights there working and stuff, they don't usually come in quite that close and try to hook you. They will another dog try to come in and hook that dog. And that rally, a dog getting rallied on, pretty not too good. But if you can free another dog up, send him over there. It's oftentimes caught things like that where they're just, instead of running off, one comes back to catch and he just...
Well, several breeds, the Dogo. We can start with the Dogo, but what don't you like about Dogos, or what is your assessment of the Dogo as a catch animal, and why did you choose? What do you think the advantages of a Great Dane or your hairy dogs is over the Dogo?
First, here in the U.S., when you start looking for a dog that does what my dogs do, the Dogo is the dog that you first see, that appears on your radar when you start looking for information, because they claim that's what the Dogo is supposed to do. He's supposed to be an all-around dog like that, be able to catch its own pigs, find its own pigs, and et cetera, et cetera. So I first got interested in Dogos and tried to acquire one, and luckily I didn't even get a little nibble on the bait that I put out there to try to get one from some prestigious kennels. I thought the Dogo was probably the way to go. And it wasn't until a little bit later on that, or just by chance, I started to create these dogs and that I have now through my own breeding, and I run into a guy who became a mentor who already had these wolfhound-based dogs, and he was very familiar with the Dogo. He'd had 17 of them from all over, from different countries, and here in America, from Denmark, Argentina, the best kennels in the world were sending Dogos to prove, and to, as he did this for a living, he caught pigs like this for a living and raised these dogs and stuff. And he was the first one that was telling me a lot about the Dogos, kind of what they are supposed to, said to be, and kind of what they are incapable of. And I was able to go with him when the client of his would come out and bring some Dogos, and got to see that for myself. Plus, kind of when I started this and I got popular in certain circles, the same thing happened to me. People would want to come out and take pictures of their Dogos holding pigs like mine do. And really try to prove get some credibility for their Dogos and for their puppies, and say that they're proven working dogs and stuff, and really get some good pictures of their Dogos holding some pigs. And I'm not sure, come out and we'll let you see what your dogs can do. And what ends up happening with Dogos, we'll take them for crop hunting. Crop hunting is easy. It's the quickest. You kind of get to see it all, and you can get to your dogs pretty quick. There's a multitude of ways to do crop hunting, but I'll take these guys crop hunting. And what happens is we'll have some pigs out in the field, and we'll slip up there with the dogs on a lead with people with like Dogos. We'll try to get the dogs in there as close as what we can. Usually on a dark night, it's 60 or 70 yards from the pig. On a full moon night or something, a night with some pretty good light, it might be 150 yards away. But anyway, the dog sees, try to walk them downwind of the pigs. I try to get the dogs to be able to see the pigs too. A lot of times they can at night. But if they can't, they know the pigs are there because of they can smell them. And they'll go to them with their nose lock onto them visually. What happens with the dogo usually is the pig will take off, or he might what we call flick the dog. The dog will go up there. The pig waits for the dog. The dog tries to make the grab, and the pig hits him, just what we call flicking the dog, just kind of hits him like kind of what we would say was kind of a stiff arm, but it just hits that dog on the way in, and he just turns around and takes off. Or the pig just turns around and takes off. The dog he's not too far behind the pig, let's say 20 foot behind the pig. But at this point, it doesn't matter whether he's been flicked or whether the pig just took off on him. That pig then, you'll also have a mile to the brush line. And then if you got that, whatever the distance, that pig is going to, he's not going to stop until he reaches the brush line or the tree line or something, somewhere where he feels confident are more secure about turning around and facing his, not accuser, but facing the threat to him. And so the dogo is running at as fast as he can, at top speed. And it can be it can be 1,000 yards, or it might be a mile if you're two crop fields deep before the brush. And the dogo is not fast enough to outrun the pig. He's fast enough to keep up with it but he can't quite close that last 10 foot. He don't have that closing speed. And so the pig just takes that dog off for a good mile run at top speed. And the dogo is exhausted. He's spent after running a mile at top speed, and he's hot. And by the time that a pig gets to the woods or to the brush where he wants to turn around, that's where the pig will give the dogo another chance to catch. Dogo usually connects there. And then he's got a hold. He's already hot. He's subject to a heat stroke. He doesn't have hardly any energy or endurance left. It's just, he's just holding out of sheer. And you've got to cover that ground. If you're on ATV or in a pickup and you get to him fast, great. If not, by the time you get to the dogo, he is spent. He's exhausted. Usually, you don't have the pig no more. The pig's got away from him because he's just gone numb. He's suffered some battering and abuse by the pig. One, because of where he's caught, the woods and stuff won't let the dog hold clean. And two, he's too tired to really hold clean anyway. And if you do get there and he does have a hold of the pig, that pig sees you, and if it's a pretty good pig, he lunges away from the dog, lunges away from you, or lunges away from, he gets scared, tries to get away from you, and the dog can't hold him. And so you're hot, you're tired, you get there, and your dog's spent, and you get there, just they're able to see the pig, and he gets away from the dog. That doesn't always happen like that, but that'll happen quite often. And it happens too often to dogo to be really successful at a long life. Heat stroke is probably going to get your dog because he just doesn't have the speed to catch on a crop field. That's my thoughts about dogos. They're real good dogs for the most part. There is a great group of people that have dogos. They kind of their own little group of people. Very nice people, usually very helpful, friendly to one another, and even to me and others. But they really think a lot more of their dogo. Their dogos are capable of more than what they really are.
How does a Great Dane, or even your hairy dogs, how do they deal with the speed of a boar in terms of trying to track one down before it gets to the tree, to the brush line?
You're with speed and efficiency. You're normally caught within 100 yards. If a dog gets, let's say the dog gets flicked. He gets up there to the pig, he gets flicked. The pig's normally caught within 100 yards. You don't get 100 yards. The hairy dog, where the hairy dog really differs from a good Great Dane, and I specify good, I feel like the Danes are, the average Dane isn't capable of work, so I specify good Dane. But when comparing a good Dane to a hairy dog, the hairy dog has got a little more, he's a lot more explosive in his speed, and so that helps. The pig isn't able to get the jump on the hairy dog the way he can with a Dane after being flicked. It's just because the Dane's got a little bit slower startup on his getting to top speed. But the Dane is really fast. He'll run a pig down pretty quick. When I say run them down pretty quick, run them down with authority. It doesn't really do you, if you're just barely fast enough to run a pig down, you're going back to the three attributes that make my top dogs so good and efficient is the speed, the hardness, and the size. And if you don't have the speed, then you're crippling yourself, and your effectiveness and your efficiency is just tanked, and your injuries are going to go up. And you're so heavily reliant upon the other two. But it's kind of, if you don't have the speed, it's kind of like trying to one-legged man trying to run a foot race.
So we're coming to the end of the program. I just wanted to give you an opportunity to, I guess, moving forward, I guess, what's your forecast for your hunting program or your work with the dogs?
Kind of where I go.
Where do you go from here? Obviously, you got a very successful program. You're very successful at getting these pigs. I know there's not necessarily an economy or a marketplace around it right now. And you're a hobbyist. Are you going to just continue? Are you going to focus more on creating more dogs? Or
it's here to stay. I don't ever foresee myself being without these top dogs. Even if the work was outlawed and stuff, I'd still be breeding for dogs like this. I might not have quite as many. I normally try to tend to keep about 7 dogs. Anyway, where I go from here, I'm playing with a little bull terrier blood. I want to add some bull terrier blood in there. And what that's going to do, I'm hoping to do, is add some, make the nerves. Bull terriers they're like such, the ones I've been around and what I have now. The ones I've have access to, they have a degree of fearlessness to them, and hardness is pretty awesome and inspiring. And the hairy dogs, especially when you get into stags and some of the sight hounds, they don't exhibit they're a little bit different as far as their character or their mentality. And they don't really exhibit what you would think of as just a hard boarhound, catch out of confidence, and they might be. They're not really shy or anything, but they're just not really, they don't really have the Dane or the Pit type mentality as far as a people person or whatever. They just kind of got their own little world, and they catch out of confidence rather than a whole lot of hardness and stuff. And their nerves, especially out here in the yard or say a stranger was to walk up or run up to the fence, instead of holding their ground, they might run to the middle of the pen and kind of turn around and look at you or a booger bark at you or something. It's just, I don't really care much for that. I want good nerves. And the bull terriers exhibit that and possess that to a greater degree than any other dog that I've been around in a much more consistent level. And the tenacity of the suckers. They about to infuse that into the dog too. Some of the Aussie dogs have the bull terrier influence in their head. I really like that about them too. That's a pretty cool characteristic. The bull terrier, I'm going to be infusing in there more Dane blood. Of course, it will have to offset that. And the bull terriers aren't really as responsive to the training. They're a little more, energetic and want to play more so. They're the most playful and friendly dogs I think I've ever seen in my life. But they want to play and stuff and not so much about learning. So we need to also offset that with a lot of the Dane blood too. But like I say, for everything you kind of add in, you dilute some other stuff. And it's kind of a dance that a lot of people don't get. It seems like very few people understand how to make those steps and to produce such a good performing dog. Placing the dogs, I got to do that with place dogs with certain people. I'll keep some dogs and my picks of the litter, and I might not be able to keep them for myself because I've got too many dogs. Like I say, I try to keep around 7 or 8. I'll place a dog with somebody who is either interested in breeding with me and doing this type of work, or somebody who's already established and I've already got going and they have. I move forward with my breeding program like that.
Your dogs aren't registered with any kennel club, right?
No, I don't have. There's no paperwork on any of my dogs. Matter of fact, even if I get a Dane, I'm not interested in paperwork.
But do you maintain a pedigree for each dog that you create?
No, I do not. No, I just.
What's there?
And these dogs are such a. There's not hardly any information known about my top dogs in the U.S. other than the few people that's been out with me or that knows me personally. You can see my dogs on the stuff and different groups, see them but you don't realize what they, you don't realize what they are or the, how different they are, the, their hunt style or anything like that. I can tell you, but the typical style of hunting pigs with bay dogs and leading catch dogs here in the U.S. is ingrained in people. It's such a different type of hunt style that it's hard for those people to comprehend. They believe through people that have tried this in the past that haven't really got, that haven't savvied the form for function type deal, who've tried to use pits and stag crosses to try to come up with type dogs I run and have failed miserably because their dogs aren't big enough or doesn't have the right characteristics, or they don't meet the three main characteristics and they'll wind up getting hurt all the time, dead, or they don't perform for one degree or another, or they're just strictly crop dogs. They're not finder holder dogs. They don't know. There's not one person in the U.S. other than my mentor that knows how to breed finder holder type dogs. And so it's very difficult to get through to people that haven't come out and experienced this, haven't seen it firsthand for themselves. And whereas they know a little bit about the Australian type finder holder, but it's kind of like something that they just read about and they don't know. It's not something that is tangible for them and they don't understand it. So for me to put paperwork on a dog, it's just, I wouldn't know how to go about doing it. And two, it'd just be meaningless. They don't know how to continue the breeding. What they do with the dog after that, they're going to breed it to something that is it just takes away everything I've done. They're going to either try to breed it to a pit or a stag, and they're going to dilute it so much in one way or another that it's not going to be the same. It's not going to be the same dog that it was. The offspring aren't going to be the same dog. Be a totally different style of dog. And they don't understand how to do it, how to breed them and stuff. And there's not a breed type, really. And so they're just scatterbred dogs, even still today. But some of I don't really have a tight line of dogs. It's the loose line if I do line breeding. And I might have long-haired dogs and short-haired dogs, you know, or slick-haired dogs in both litters. I might have one that looks, that has a pretty thin head. One of the reasons I don't like a lot of stag influence. They might throw pretty hard to the stag features, or you will have some that resemble more of a mastiff type structure or features. Really, really, really impressive looking boar type dogs. And I don't know. I haven't been at it long enough to, and there's not a big enough program that I have going on to really get a consistent style down, because I'm always adding stuff in and trying to create more dogs. It seems like you can get a litter perfect right where you want to be, but then what do you do when you get there? You've got to bring others up behind that are not, that aren't too a tight line bred, that you can breed them to one another. So it would take a bigger organization than what I have going on now to really do any kind of ring or paperwork on them or anything like that. But as far as I can see,
that's what I was thinking. Just if you just were keeping pedigrees, just so you could kind of have some idea formula, because I think what you're doing is great, and it sounds like the dogs are amazing. So it would be great if someone wanted to pick up where you left off or help you continue.
Yeah.
There was some sort of blueprint for them to at least access. Obviously, you would want them to probably, like you mentor, you have a mentor, you could be their mentor. And maybe at some point we have a whole new type of honey dog.
My mentor kind of was very interested in that at one time with the Danes, and found that there's not enough interest in Danes to do it. And the Danes are just one in, it almost seems like 1 in 7 or 1 in 8 that you get will be a really good usable dog, even though you were pretty diligent in getting something that you thought was going to work out. It's fun. 1 in 7 or 1 in 8 will be really top-notch top dogs. And whenever you find one, you can't ask for a better pig dog or boarhound. But it takes going through so many Danes to finally get that one. The people are, there's a lot of interest in Danes, especially with the pet breeders, to see working Danes. It seems like from the show dog people to the pet owners, even though that they consider them their fur babies, and they think it's just kind of cruelty if they don't live in the house and and so forth, they still get a big kick out of seeing my Danes do perform this type of work, holding big old pigs. They get excited. They kind of live vicariously through them, through my dogs. But still, even there, Danes are easy to, a litter of Danes is easy to move, but sending a Dane to a pet to a working home, and they don't savvy the patience and the time it takes to mature a Dane. They kind of, they want a dog that's already, that's going and catching at about a year old. They consider everything. They know pits, they're familiar with pits. And they want everything fast the way a pit does. Like when a pit turns on, it shows three, four more pigs later, and boom, you got your finished catch dog there almost. But with a Dane, they mature so much slower mentally and physically than the smaller dogs that the people just don't really have the patience. They don't have the understanding and the knowledge that it takes to really develop these big dogs like this. And I don't see really much interest in it at all. It's just something that I'm good at and something that I like, and I don't push really the Dane or anything. I just try to make a better hairy dog, and there seems to be some pretty good interest in hairy dogs, and the crop doggers also are, they can use my dog, these hairy dogs especially, not just, there's really not a lot of interest in the finder holder work with most guys getting my dogs. It's a lot of the crop work, and I think there's multiple ways to do crop work. I do crop work much differently than what most guys do. I do it in a finder holder type form or fashion.
Explain to me what crop work.
Crop work is like wheat fields are with what we have around here. We also have hay grazer and stuff, kind of like sugar cane. But most of my crop work is wheat fields, and you can, except for one crop that the wheat gets mature, the dogs are tall enough to see over it and see the pigs in it and stuff. And it's just that you'll have basically a crop field that the dogs can scan and see pigs in or smell pigs in. And the pigs, they like to come to the fields and eat at night, shoot you all of them, have 100 pigs in a field. Or the farmers, they really don't know. You can go out there and look with thermal or night vision and kind of get an eye for and show that to farmhand, they get pretty surprised. The crop work is basically catching pigs on crop fields, and that entails a fast dog. Most people use what's called a staghound. I don't really think they're proper for that job, but they kind of get the job done. A staghound is a cross between a greyhound and a deerhound. It's predominantly greyhounds for the most part. They're used for catching coyotes, running down and catching coyotes in the plain states like Kansas, Nebraska. There's a lot of them in Oklahoma, even in the Dakotas. They love to catch coyotes with them, run coyotes down with them, and catch them and dispatch them with those dogs. And also they'll run down and jackrabbits. A lot of people like to hunt jackrabbits with them. But they're really not built for catching pigs, but they're fast enough to do it. Some of them are hard enough for pack dogs. And what they'll do is they'll go out on the crop fields with these stag-type dogs or predominantly pit and stag crosses and lead them dogs out there with thermal, aided by thermal, finding pigs with thermal, and lead their dogs out there on a lead, about three of them. And they get, just kind of like I say, I did with the Dogo people, get them as close as you can with the dogs and let them know that the pigs are there. And then before turning them loose, turn the dogs loose and they'll run them pigs down with authority and catch them right there in the field before they can get out of the field. That's what people envision or crop work is being done as, but I do it a little differently. I'll still use thermal or night vision to verify that there's pigs on the field. I'm pretty well aware of which direction the wind's coming from. And I'll typically approach a field from downwind. I don't like the pigs smelling me. It doesn't matter if there is a crosswind or a big deal. As long as they're not, the pigs can't smell me. But I do like it. But I do prefer the dogs being able to be upwind of the pigs. I'll drive by the field or drive up to a field. If pigs are there, I just kill the pickup. When I kill the pickup, the dogs know there's pigs there, and they jump off. And they just cast themselves out there, and they just kind of make a circle until they pick up the scent, until they win the pigs out there, or just kind of silly stumble across them, whether it be by hearing or vision or something. And if they make a big, if you got a big 240-acre wheat field out there, they might not, if there's pigs on one corner of it, they might not find them, might not make a big enough circle or something if they're not downwind. And I'll walk out that direction or drive out that direction to get a little closer or something, and the dogs will kind of go to them. I will occasionally, when I have guests or kids or in the summertime, when it's hot, I'll put my dogs on a lead and walk them out there just so we ain't got to run as far if I'm able. My dogs run around loose on the back of the pickup, and when I kill the pickup, they get off and they go out there. If there's fields on both sides of me, they won't go, unless they smell the pigs, they won't go into one field or another. They'll take their direction from me. I'll get out in my pickup, and I'll head to one field or another, one fence or another, and when I head to that fence, there they go underneath it, and then they just take it from there. And I either run out there behind them, or I just set in the pickup till they, or the ATV, whichever, set in the pickup or ATV till they catch, and then I go to the gate and go in there.
So with that being said, can you describe to me, just for definition's sake, finder holder work?
Finder holder work I do with the same dogs, my same dogs that I'm catching these pigs on the crop field. That's just hunting the dog in the woods. It's a catch dog. It's a descriptive term for type dog. The finder is he's finding the pig, and a holder, he's catching the pig. Finder lugger, finder holder. It's an Australian type of term, a descriptive term to identify the dog and how he works. And finder holder style for me, when I say that, is I'm hunting the woods, and the dog will either win off the back of your truck or an ATV, whatever you got the dog on. That's really the only method that I don't hunt. I've got the way the property is laid out, the ranches that I hunt. They're not all behind one fence. You'll have different properties or different owners scattered about amongst the different properties. And also, too, in the certain times of the year, I just strictly crop hunt. Whether it's a deer season, hunting season here in Texas, it runs a long time. And as a service to the landowners, they like for me to catch the pigs on the crop fields, but they don't want the drama with the hunters. But they don't want the hunters knowing that I'm there, and so I stay out of the woods. And so my pigs are, if I hunted that style of dogs, and I wouldn't have control over which dogs my pigs selected. They just smell some pigs and in the woods as I was checking fields, and off they go. They're going in the woods, and boom, I'm getting caught on game cameras, and I'm creating drama for the landowners, with the hunters, and so forth. I've been pretty fortunate with the landowners, got a good reputation so far. I've not caused no drama between landowners and hunters, and I'm pretty proud of that after 6 years of doing this. How I do hunt the dogs is I'll put them on the ground and drive with my pickup down the pasture roads or ATV and let them win pigs that way. Or I'll walk. I do a lot of walk hunting. My dogs are pretty what I call short range dogs, which means they have a short range, medium range, and long range was what the people here in the U.S. kind of classify their finding their bay dogs as, their strike dogs. And what that is, kind of the distance away from you that these dogs will go out and hunt. They're just actively looking for pigs or searching for scent in which to then follow off. But my dogs are short-range dogs. They typically will hang out between 20 and 100 yards from me, kind of just kind of checking for scent and checking brush and stuff. They kind of hunt a lot like I do. I'll go over to thickets and stuff and look in them. My dogs do that too, and they're a little product of me. But if I change directions, my dogs change directions. My dog takes their direction from me. But they're out there in front of me looking for pigs and out to about 100 yards. If my dogs roll out to about 200 yards, then I'm headed their way because I know that's not typical for them just to wander away from me from that far unless they've got a reason to. And that reason is their nose has led them off that way. They've winned some pigs. And they often win pigs out to about 600 yards away from me. Most of the time, they're around 300 to 400 yards. They leave. When they smell pigs, I can... And if I don't see them, I'm constantly watching my Garmin and my GPS. And if I'm not in visual contact with my dogs, and when they start rolling out and they get over about 200 yards, I know to head their way. It kind of shortens the time in which it takes me to get there if I'm already headed that way, and it reduces their hold time, the time in which they're holding the pig. Anyway, so just I'm walking or just driving, and the dog is on the ground in the woods, actively trying to find its own pigs. And I do that, I incorporate that into my style of crop dogging, which is not something that is synonymous with other crop doggers or their type dogs. It's not something that stags are really, it's not their style of hunt. A stag doesn't really hunt with his nose. Stag usually kind of has a good nose, but a lot better nose than what you think it does. But he doesn't use it for hunting. For instance, he's more sight driven. And I hate to get off on that, but I can tell you about a stag's nose. He can be up doing the lead training or trotting one down the road with a pickup. And there might be a scent post from a coyote or some scat in the bar ditch, or where one has marked his territory on a little stand of grass that kind of sticks out. And that dog will, he'll be at a lope going by that and just slam on the brakes, come to a slide and stop, and go back and the smell of that scent post and or that dried coyote turd that's been there for a week. And he didn't see that, but he smelled it. And he smells pigs out there in the crop field that's 300 yards away. But a lot of stags, it doesn't register to them unless they see it. And so it's a way they process how they hunt. Their nose is better than what you think, but how they process, how they hunt is really not through their nose. It doesn't register. but you can watch a stag, and you can sure tell that there's better nose there than what you think. They just don't use it for hunting.
I just want to give you one more question before we go. And I wanted to ask you, because we didn't really talk about how long it takes for you to get a dog from, in terms of a Great Dane, even your hairy dog, how old are they once they, because you were saying that the pit bull will develop very, very, two or three pigs, he's already a catch dog. What's the development process? What are the stages of your bigger dog?
That is something, too, that they really try to work on with either pit or bull terrier blood, is trying to get these bigger dogs to fire off earlier. My hairy dogs, typically, I will start using them, taking them out on a hunt, and it's just usually I'll take how I typically do that with a young hairy dog or any kind of young dog for that matter, is I'll take two of my main dogs and one pup. And so I've actually got three dogs on the ground at that point, taking three dogs with me at that point, and just kind of letting that dog get used to going through fences, because most all the fields and pastures and everything, we have lots of fences here, and so a dog's got to learn to negotiate the fences, get through them. And for the first couple of hunts, he's got a problem doing that. He don't hardly ever make it to a catch because he's always hung up on fences, and he'll finally learn how to do that. But I'll start taking that dog at about a year old, at about 12 months old, and in about 3 or 4 weeks, he is typically lugging up on at the catches. Like he'll lug up with another dog. He's not catching his own pig, and he's not hunting his own pig. But when he gets to the catch, he's interested in them, and he'll go over there and he'll lug up on that pig. Shortly after that, he'll start following them dogs off, and when they take off, he knows the gig, he'll go with them, and he'll start lugging up. It's not but a hunt or two that he starts doing that after he starts lugging up. And at about 14 months, what I have seen with my dogs is, my hairy dogs, is that's when they will typically start catching their own pigs. What happens there is they'll start catching their own pig, but they won't quite have the confidence to catch one. Say they out of a mob, they want to pick their own pig. The lead dog catches his own pig, and that young dog, he follows another pig off. Here he's kicking off. He's 250, 350. He's just chasing his pig, but he won't commit to the catch. Then 400, 450, 550. He might get out to 700 yards, and I know he's fast enough to catch that pig, but and he ought to have that pig caught if he really wants to, but he just don't. And he ain't come back. It ain't gonna be that two or three more weeks, and he's gonna be catching his own pig. And somewhere in the 14th month, usually probably some dogs it's early in the 14th month, some dogs it's later in the 14th month. But almost all of my good dogs and my good hairy dogs I've had, my lead dogs, have all developed. They have all started catching their own pig at about 14 months old. But the Dane being a full blood dog like that, without any pit or anything in it to try to influence it like that, they might not even be interested at a year old. A Dane, sure, hope they are, but the one I've got now, he just turned 14 months old. He's been lugging up with a lead dog now for almost about 2.5 months, and maybe 3 months. And he's just now kind of starting to track his own, and he's starting to catch some small pigs, not a little below average, I'll put it that way. And I don't really expect him to start catching his own pigs until he is 18 or 19 months old. And that's just sure a long time to wait. I've had other Danes that, they were catching their own pigs at 13 months old. It's with a, if you cross from pit to a dog like a Dane, you sure help things out, speed things along. A Dane cross to me is a lot better dog than a full dog. It's a lot more handier dog. I love a Dane. The thing that it, the features, the physical features that it, they add to the cross and to the hunt style. I love their hunt style. They are an independent dog. They're more out to catch their own pig without any other dogs being there. A lot of dogs that you'll come across, they won't catch their own pig unless another dog's there with them. Dane, typically, he's not like that. He don't care if another dog's there or not. He don't care if you take him by himself. What he's gonna go out there and perform his job. And I love it. Dane typically has a really good nose and a very good mind to use it. The Danes can actually be too long range for my liking. Set up, my dogs are usually short range dogs, but I've had some Danes that they're long range dogs, and I don't like that. It takes too long to get there. And kind of like we mentioned with the Dogo earlier, if the longer it takes you to get to a catch, especially when it's hot and summertime, in the middle of the summer night, if a pig was to carry the dog off, like if it was to get to a fence, and then be able to get to the fence and put a little distance between the Dane and the pig, and then get through the brush, run through a creek, and get 500 yards on the into the pasture or the brush before the Dane catches it, you're more out to, the Dane's going to get hot. So the sooner you can get there, the better. And I kind of lost my track there with what I was going there, what I meant by that. But Dane crosses. To me, the Dane crosses are just a lot better, a lot more user-friendly, and a lot more. I love what a Dane throws with a cross, the hunt style and everything. They throw a good nose typically with a cross. Their feet are really good, especially with a sight hound. A lot of times sight hounds have big old long toes on them, kind of a coon-footed looking thing. That's not really up my alley. It's not what I really want to breed for. I like a good solid structure on my dog, good foot and everything. It's something that's conducive to the finder-holder style of hunting, rather than the coursing type dogs. And a Dane just really helps bring all that together, especially if there's a little pit in there and stuff to help bring about the characteristics that a Dane used to be.
All right. So I'm going to go ahead and wrap it up. All right, Mr. Ross, I want to thank you for your time and your information. I definitely appreciate you sharing all of your wealthy information. Start that over. This is my first podcast. The good thing, though, is that I edited it so that this is not a live thing. You know, all the information is there, so I just have to organize it. That's
okay, good deal.
All right, so let me try that again. All right, Mr. All right, Dean, thank you so much for your time and for sharing your information with us. I appreciate it. If anyone wanted to get in contact with you, do you have any social media, anywhere social? Try that again. Okay, Dean, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate you sharing your information and your knowledge. If anyone in the audience want to get in touch with you via social media, is there any place that you prefer them contacting you?
They can find me on Facebook. I believe it's open to the public. It's not a private. It's DeaneRoss. I think there's a couple of different pages of mine up there. One I don't have access to. I didn't remember the passcode and stuff. So I don't even, it's not active. You just have to, if you find that one, I normally post. I normally go hunting about once a week. And so generally I have new pictures or videos up there weekly. And so if you come by one that has been inactive for months, that's not me. Or it was me, but it's not. So you can keep looking. My dog, my Facebook will have the avatar. It's one, will be one big red dog holding a big boar. And that's me. You won't find any. It just shows my dogs. It's just, it doesn't show me. I've got some pictures of some other people on there and stuff, but you never see me on there. It's just all about my dogs.
All right, sir. Thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it. You have a wonderful evening, okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you. All right, Dean. Thanks, man. I do appreciate it. Did you hang up?
No, sir.
Okay. Did you hang up? Okay. Yeah, no. So that's going to be the end of the show, but I'm going to edit it. There you go. I got it.